And welcome. Thank you for taking time out of your day and spending it with us. We're super excited to have this webinar today. This is part of the Culture of Academic Medicine initiative from the AFMC's Wellbeing Matters webinar series. And the title of this session is Culture Change in Academic Medicine, Building a Theory of Change. My name is Victor. I'm a fourth year peds resident at U of T for another couple months, provided I pass my exams. I have the pleasure of co-chairing the Culture of Academic Medicine Initiative and helping host and welcome Dr. Marcia Anderson. The two of you can just advance. So I'll just start with our land acknowledgement. So I'm coming from Toronto, and I'd like to acknowledge that I'm joining from the traditional land of the Huron-Wendat, the Seneca, and the Mississaugas of the Credit. AFMC hosts these webinars, and we acknowledge that the AFMC itself is situated on traditional territory of the Algonquin Anishinaabe peoples. And we'd like everyone to take a moment to respectfully acknowledge the traditional owners and caretakers of the land from which you are joining. And alongside that, as we think about today's topic around culture change in medicine, also the role that we have on in Indigenous reconciliation and part of our journey in medicine. So just before we get to formal introductions and moving things forward, just some housekeeping. So the initial part of the webinar before we get to all the Q&A is recorded, and we often turn these into a recording that others can watch when they're not able to come. Everyone is automatically muted and videos off just to kind of avoid distractions, but we do encourage interaction throughout. So Dr. Anderson will be using Slido and different things, and then there's a Q&A function which we invite questions, and then when we get to the question interaction component, you'll also have an opportunity to raise your hand, and you'll be able to kind of speak and do that together. And we hope to really create a space where we can have thoughtful conversations and learnings together through this virtual space. So we ask everyone to be respectful in that together. So it's my pleasure to introduce our speaker for this event, which is Dr. Marcia Anderson. Dr. Anderson is a graduate from the University of Manitoba, a past president of the Indigenous Physicians Association of Canada, and currently Vice Dean, Indigenous Health, Social Justice, and Anti-Racism at the Rady Faculty of Health Sciences at the University of Manitoba. Marcia, thank you so much for taking this time to provide this webinar to everyone. I know I'm going to learn a lot, and I'm sure all our participants will through this concept and topic around theory of change and our approach to kind of well-being conversations, which we get lots of questions and topics on. So we'll be soaking everything up. Thanks again.
Thank you, Victor, and thank you for coming, everybody. I'm assuming everyone can hear me okay and can also see the slides. So while I introduce myself a bit more, I'm just going to go ahead and put this joining slide up here for Slido. Don't worry, it will also be on every slide we're going to use the interactions for. So if you don't get it right now, you will get a chance to join later as well. And just to note, you can use your phone and scan the QR code, or you can go to slido.com and enter in the code that you see there, and that will take you to the polls and questions that we're going to use today. So Hamatakia Pepete Dutuina Makiaye, Nandwe Benisik Nadishnikas, Chante Washte Nanpe Chizapeye. So I'm Cree and Anishinaabe. I'm joining today from Treaty One territory and the homeland of the Red River Métis Nation. My family is from Treaty One. My dad's a member of Pegwas First Nation. My grandpa's family also had roots up in Norway House, Manitoba. And I love talking about organizational culture, leadership strategies, and culture change, which is a really good thing for me because that is kind of the core mandate or core business of Indigenous health, social justice, and anti-racism. And I have been doing this work actually for about 20 years now. I was around Victor's stage of learning when I first became a co-chair at the AFMC. So now you know what you're in for. And I co-chaired the first Aboriginal Health Task Group there. Okay. So the first question I have, and I'll just take a couple of minutes for people to respond here, is when you think about the kind of culture change that needs to happen, what comes to mind for you? So I'll just give you a minute again to either scan the code or join on the code there and then start inputting your words. And as you can see, they're going to start to pop up as you fill it in. So radical. Other thoughts about the types of culture change, more humility, mindfulness or being more mindful, recognizing privilege, power shifting, redefining, being more open-minded, actively addressing racism and oppression, less stigma about mental illness, action, maybe just action-oriented in general, more inclusive, more holistic approaches, willingness to change, bridging rural divides, moving from hierarchies of power, more appropriate communication. You can see inclusive and humility growing as keywords that are being repeated, embedding wellness into the culture. Okay. So all great aspects of culture change that we need to be working towards. I'm going to move to the next question. Sorry if you're still typing. I think we're getting a really good picture of the understanding of the breadth of culture change that we are seeking in medical education. And so now I want you to think about leaders in academic medicine, current, coming up, future. What new skills do leaders need to have in order to lead these types of culture changes? Okay, humility again here. We'll just give it a few more minutes to see what is coming up. Change leadership. Not sure if that means change management or just like change all the people in leadership. Listening, reflexivity, listening to opposing views, networking skills. Seeing anti-racism and EDI as fundamental, proactive, seeking feedback, getting better at receiving feedback, maybe even self-awareness, compassion, clinicians, not just academic. So I'm going to take that to mean we need to have parallel changes in the academic settings, knowing when to move on, because we need different forms of excellence sometimes in some leadership positions, wellness-centered, emotional intention, intelligence. Great answers here. So what I am mostly going to focus on today is cultural safety and anti-Indigenous racism, because as you've already noted, the breadth of culture change work that needs to happen is wide. For the purposes of this talk, I'm going to focus on anti-Indigenous racism and cultural safety, and just trust that everyone will find some parallels or nuggets that applies to the type of culture change work that you are doing. And, you know, you leave some of the rest behind or maybe put it in the mind bank somewhere for another time when it might be more relevant to you. And so just really briefly, so we're all on the same page about what I mean by cultural safety, I'll actually start on the right side. So Kuka Margaret Lavallee is an Anishinaabe elder we've worked here with at Ongamazin for years now, years and years. When we asked her to kind of translate the term cultural safety for our updated training program, this is what she gave us, Giga Mino Genowinin Anishinaabe, which roughly translates into, we will take good care of the people, or taking good care of the people in a good way, right? And that is something that is more meaningful kind of at the community level to the people receiving care perhaps than some of the technical definitions we use, which are also important for us. And I've included the definitions from FNHA here, an outcome of respectful engagement based on recognition of the power imbalances inherent in the health system and the work to address these imbalances. And that a culturally safe environment results in an environment free of racism and discrimination. And as we all know, that's as experienced by the patient or the Indigenous learner in a learning environment. And then just very briefly, this is the definition I mostly use of racism, which is the system of assigning value and structuring opportunity based on the social interpretation of how one looks or what we call race. And the three steps there are naming racism, asking how is it operating here, and then organizing and strategizing to act. This requires understanding that while the structure or the roots of racism are the same, they're about those definitions of superiority and inferiority, of a disadvantaged and advantaged access to power, money, and resources, that the way it plays out in Canadian society has been different, right? And so how anti-Black racism evolved here and how it was used in the development of the Canadian statement was parallel, but was different than how anti-Indigenous racism evolved, for example. And so we need to understand both the commonalities as well as the specificity of different forms of racism and the different levels at which it occurs. And so when we think about cultural safety and anti-racism in medical education, what type of solutions are needed to support this culture change? And I've only given you three options here: technical solutions, adaptive solutions, or I need more information to be able to respond to this question. So I'll just give you a moment to respond here. If you've seen one of my talks this year on culture change already, you have a bit of an advantage. Yeah. Now, both of these responses are fair. So sometimes I am asked, why haven't we made more progress yet in these changes, right? Because there is no evidence that we are closing gaps in healthcare quality for Indigenous peoples. I'm not aware of any evidence showing that Indigenous learners are now experiencing less racism than I experienced as an Indigenous learner, for example. That being said, we can point to things that we have done that are evidence of progress, right? Like maybe there are improvements in process. And I'll point to some of these here, right? Specifically, again, related to cultural safety and anti-racism. Within the RADIA Faculty of Health Sciences, we do actually have a TRC action plan. MIST was our cultural safety training that we used over the last many years that we're now updating and relaunching. We've signed on to the Scarborough Charter that's actually related to anti-Black racism and Black flourishing. We have an anti-racism policy, which we've just renewed. We do have an EDI policy. There's a prevention of learner mistreatment policy. There's a respectful work and learning environment policy. All of these should be contributing to a more safe environment with less experiences of racism or lack of cultural safety. And then in the health system, and I'm talking about Manitoba's health system here, there is a commitment to disrupting racism. Last year, we started collecting race-based data to be able to measure and intervene in healthcare quality gaps by race. There are some TRC action plans depending on the service delivery organization. The Northern Regional Health Authority has an anti-Indigenous racism policy and similar access to RWLE policies and MIST. So why haven't these created the kind of change that we want to see? And I always come back to this one, right? That culture eats strategy for breakfast. Those are all really important technical solutions, technical elements of the solution or strategies. And of their own, they're not going to create the differences that we need to see. And for folks who might not be as aware of what we might call more technical challenges or more adaptive challenges, I've included this chart from what I think is a helpful blog article on accelerating organizational anti-racism work. So I'd encourage you to, look that up there. You can maybe see the title down at the bottom to Google. So what he says about technical challenges are that the root causes are easy to identify, right? Whereas in adaptive challenges, sometimes they're difficult to identify, but importantly, they can be easy to deny, right? Technical challenges often lend themselves to cut and dried solutions, where adaptive challenges require changes in beliefs, values, roles, relationships, approaches to work. Therefore, they're much harder, right? Technical challenges can often be solved by an authority or by an expert, right? Whereas in adaptive challenges, people who are most impacted by the problem need to provide leadership in how we solve it, right? Who may not be the people in authority when we think about who is most represented at different levels of health system or university leadership. Technical challenges often require change in just one or a few places, often contained within organizational boundaries, whereas adaptive challenges like anti-racism and cultural safety require change in numerous places and usually across organizational boundaries, right? Like, we are never going to have the kind of success we want to see if we aren't making parallel changes in the clinical learning environments. People are generally receptive to technical solutions, to technical challenges, or to technical challenges, whereas people often resist even acknowledging adaptive challenges. So this can sound like there's no bias in our hiring or selection processes. We hire for excellence, right? That kind of denial, the resistance of acknowledgement. And in technical challenges, solutions can be implemented quickly, even by edict, like the thou shalt do this. Whereas adaptive solutions require experiments and new discoveries. They can take a long time to implement and they can't be implemented by edict, right? And so when we think about those differences between technical and adaptive challenges, where do you think that the strengths of current academic medical leaders tend to lie? And of course, this is very tied to how we've defined excellence in the past, and how we define excellence currently too. And when you do have a primarily technical problem, it's much easier to design a technical solution, get published for it, get recognized for it, and have that kind of career advancement, right? The adaptive, for many reasons, are more difficult. I think the other reflection I would offer here is that piece at the bottom that was around adaptive solutions taking longer, requiring experimentation. There's a lot of uncertainty in there. There's probably some failure in there, some need for humility and self-compassion. Those are traits that, on average, physicians in academic medical leadership positions are really known for. It's not been well rewarded in our culture to have those traits. So a couple of my favorite quotes around this, I will just mention briefly, I'm also a certified executive coach and I've done additional training in group and team coaching and psychological safety as well. And so more than my internal medicine training, this informs the day-to-day work that I do. And I find it as interesting as like aortic stenosis murmurs, which are one of my favorite things to pick up. But anyways, what Ron Heifetz says around this is the most common leadership failure stems from trying to apply technical solutions to adaptive challenges, right? And I think about what is the difference between, you know, generating a call schedule that everyone is happy with, as hard as that is, to reducing the microaggressions people experience in a workplace, right? The technical solution is not going to have the effect on the microaggressions, for example. But the technical solution will always look like the easier thing to do, whether it works or not. So if we are privileging being seen to do something or acting quickly, which we've often been trained to do, we might actually slow things down by trying to implement an ineffective technical solution to these big adaptive challenges first. Now, Jerry Johnson, in one of his books, he's another leadership and organizational culture scholar. He said, when it comes to major strategic change, paradigm shifts are likely to be important, and they are obviously the most difficult to achieve. I'm not actually sure that it's as obvious to everybody, but once you hear it, you're like, yeah, that makes sense, right? It's going to be difficult. And a paradigm, just again, to state a definition so we're all on the same page, is a core set of beliefs and assumption which fashions an organization's view of itself and its environment. So I'm going to go back to the Slido, and as it relates to the topic of our webinar today on culture change, as it relates to anti-Indigenous racism and cultural safety, what are some of the key elements of the relevant health paradigms of healthcare and medical education? So we'll give folks a minute to pick their devices back up or use their webinars again. Yeah, so authority, the need for more Indigenous physicians. So the paradigm there might be around Indigenous people being unqualified to be represented as physicians, hierarchical forms of organization or power, how we define excellence and merit, colonization, power over, definitions of the meritocracy, solo or hero leadership versus collective leadership, so some individualism in there, singular view of meritocracy. Okay, lack of representation, inequity, capitalism, the lonely hero is celebrated. Okay, thank you for those thoughts. You know, I'm going to switch to the next slide. I am moving forward just to make sure we have abundant time for discussion at the end. You know, when I reflect on some of the paradigms of Canadian healthcare, in addition to what was written there, some of that analysis, which I really appreciate and will build from, I will also note that on average, people in Canada do actually think about hospital-based services, physician services as a right, right? And because of the principles of the Canada Health Act and how that has evolved, sometimes people actually think that we have a very egalitarian approach to healthcare, or that healthcare treats everybody the same or provides everybody the same opportunity. And I think that that is fundamentally untrue, actually, right? And so we can look at the evolution of Indian healthcare, and I'm going to use the term Indian in its historical context here, to actually see how the founding paradigm of Indian healthcare was incredibly different. So Indian healthcare evolved out of public health control measures to try to control the spread of infectious diseases like tuberculosis from Indian people who were placed in more concentrated areas with inadequate housing and food insecurity conditions that led to higher rates of TB. So to isolate them from passing on risk to settlers to Canada, right? That's where the sanatoriums came from, which led to some of the segregated Indian hospitals. If you have read some of the work around the nutritional experiments in residential schools, we were also considered like a captive lab audience for experimentation, for medical experimentation designed to benefit other people, right? And I also think about what my colleagues, Dr. Dryden and Dr. Norm, talked about when they came here to U of M a couple of years ago, when they talked about how, when we're kind of thinking about the evolution of healthcare and medical education, we think about them occurring at the same points in time as the kind of progressive end of the enslavement of African peoples in Canada, but also the progress of residential schools, for example, in the PASS system and different elements of the Indian Act, and how the kind of core racist ideology around Indigenous peoples embedded in those things were replicated in parallel across medical education and healthcare as well, right? And so these start to be embedded in that below the surface organizational culture, right? These come out in some of those anti-Indigenous stereotypes that we see replicated and we hear over and over again, unfortunately. And I would really encourage people to read the In Plain Sight report, which does a really good job of articulating some of the stereotypes based on their evidence gathering processes. But, you know, a really key one continues to be around Indigenous peoples and substance use, right? That becomes a shared assumption just below the surface, right? How we treat Indigenous people who are more likely to leave against medical advice without kind of understanding why or what else might meet their needs is maybe part of a tradition or an unwritten rule that if you're not going to do what I say, you're not going to get any health care then, right? There's no kind of next best thing planning often. And so the things, the elements I referred to before are reconciliation action plans, our educational interventions, our policies. Those are all the things we say, the way we say we think get things done. And then we have all these things happening below the surface. And this is where a lot of that paradigm shifting work has to occur. Now, someone or a few people mentioned power over and hierarchies when we were talking in those previous slidos. And healthcare and medical education well recognized hierarchical cultures, right? And you can see some of the characteristics there. And what I want to note is this is not inherently bad. And at times, it's actually protective and beneficial. I think about, for example, kind of the first year I was practicing medicine as an attending physician and kind of feeling uncertain and almost grieving the loss of the safety net that having an attending physician that I could report to, double check, bounce things off of, was expected to do all that, who would catch a mistake for me, ideally, right? Kind of lost that and grieved that a little bit. So some hierarchy makes sense and is quite functional. Hierarchy in itself is not toxic. It can become toxic when we see it or use it as more power over as opposed to responsibility for and with, right? And so we all know when this becomes toxic. And for example, if a more junior person challenges a more senior person and then they get labeled insubordinate, right? For example, or when there is resistance to feedback across power differentials, another example. And so the seniority one is one that can become toxic, doesn't have to be inherently, but then also we need to be mindful of and acknowledge that this is layered on top of other forms of dysfunctional structured hierarchies, right? Along lines of race or gender or ability. And that informs the overall experience of people in this hierarchy. And so this is my favorite quote on organizational change. And what it says is that change alters power relationships and undermines existing agreements and pacts. Even more profoundly, it intrudes on deeply rooted symbolic forms, traditional ways, icons, and rituals. Below the surface, an organization's cultural tapestry begins to unravel, threatening time-honored traditions, prevailing cultural values and ways, and shared meaning. So I will admit, in my early career years, it was quite a surprise to me that people did not love change as much as I did. Okay. Most people, in fact, do not like change, especially if they're not the ones driving it. And so I really put a lot of effort in trying to understand why that is and how to do change better. And so I've reflected on this quote quite a lot, as well as my observations and experiences in the now 26 years I've been involved in medical education. And to me, this really encapsulates the kind of tensions and work towards racial justice and in work to preserve white supremacy or advantaged white access to power, money, resources, and opportunities, right? Because a lot of the existing agreements and pacts that we have rested in who was in power and had the power to define excellence and meritocracy, who could set it up to be best served by that. And so these different elements, like the traditional ways, the rituals, the unspoken and spoken agreements, all serve a population group, right? And perhaps we could think about unions and some of the pushback to designated hiring positions in here. But when I look at this quote, it is with a lens in which these organizations were really not made with people like me or from my communities in mind. Our cultures, we have made progress on this, but by and large, our cultures were not reflected, right? They're not our time-honored traditions. They're not our cultural values and ways. They're not shared meanings that benefit us, especially when we think about how anti-Indigenous stereotypes actually really harm Indigenous patients receiving care. And so that's why when I look at this quote, I get excited and I'm like, yes, this is exactly what we need to do. And there are many other people who will look at this quote and feel differently, right? Who will be like, what about excellence? And will need to be open to hearing other forms of excellence that don't trade off on the medical expertise knowledge, but make it more likely that that medical expertise knowledge gets to an increasingly diverse set of patients equitably, right? So a few years back, I kind of developed this anti-racism change model to try to help capture some of my lessons or my learnings and thinkings around this. And so first of all, I've represented it like a teeter-totter. And that is because it's critical we understand that when we're talking about anti-racism change, we're not talking about a finish line that we need to get to and then we're done and now we have a racially just world, right? The reality is, and this is well chronicled in Ibram X. Kendi's book on Stamped from the Beginning, it's called, is that throughout history, there are dual and dueling forces for racial justice and for white supremacy and different forms of racism, right? And we always have to keep in mind that racism existed and continues to exist because it benefits some people. And people don't have to have any intention of benefiting from it in order to benefit from it or to be kind of tacitly involved in the system of it. So let's keep in mind, I'm not saying everyone is bad or anything like that, but the reality is, and we don't need to look far to see these like attacks on critical race theory, attacks on designated admissions pathways, attacks on designated scholar hires or things like that, to see that kind of backlash, that attempt to tip the balance in favor of the status quo and who it's been serving. So we're in this teeter-totter balance. And then I was also thinking about how do decisions get made in organizations? And in many cases, decisions in meetings, board meetings, et cetera, get made by majority vote, right? You have to get more people who are gonna vote for something that is more likely to cause more racial equity than people who will vote for the status quo. And so how do we change the behavior of people or the actions of people? And so the cycles on the top are actually from the Dalai Lama's book, I guess from The Art of Happiness. And he talks about, you know, how people move through the cycle of like learning to conviction, to determination, to act, to actually taking action. And that's a really key point because until people make an action that is different, they don't actually tip the balance at all in favor of anti-racist impacts or more racially just outcomes. And we can't be naive. Right? We have to understand that on the other side of the teeter-totter, a learning cycle is also getting on. People are seeing what happened under Trump's reign and are like, why don't we try this in Alberta or closer to home too, right? These are very proximate to us. Now, what does this mean for leaders in particular? And I think this is a really important quote about anti-racism when it comes to leadership. And so what Ijeoma Oluo says is the beauty of anti-racism is that you don't have to pretend to be free of racism to be an anti-racist. Anti-racism is the commitment to fight racism wherever you find it, including yourself, and it's the only way forward, right? And in fact, if we pretend that we're anti-racist or non-racist, instead of being open to seeing the racism in ourselves, we are more likely to cause harm, right? This goes back to some of those early responses around we need to have more self-reflection and more humility. And this is more important in leaders to role model for the kind of culture change that we want to see first and foremost. Everybody, leaders first. And so now when I think about the anti-racist change model, I also think about what's going on in the iceberg, right? Because the vote in the board meeting, et cetera, that's all happening above the surface, but all that below the surface stuff is happening in organizations too. And not only is it happening in organizations, it's happening internally, like in each of us. We have the above the waterline things that we say, our commitments, the protests we show up to, et cetera. And then there's the question of, do we do the work to illuminate the blind spots that are maybe hidden below the surface, to acknowledge the discomfort and dig into it when we feel it, to commit to trying something differently, even if it feels uncomfortable, and seeing if it improves and has a more positive racially just outcome. Like, this model applies at the individual level as well. And so when we are confronted with these big adaptive challenges in organizations, usually what we rush to, which is necessary but not sufficient, is the educational intervention, right? And because we are updating and renewing our cultural safety education a lot, I've been thinking a lot around how do we translate this into organizational culture change, right? And so Cotter's change model, he wrote a book called The Heart of Change. He talks about how, you know, if you want to produce individual change, you have to see something that makes them feel something different, and then that can lead to change. It's an oversimplification. And when I think about the C part, I think about not trauma porn. Most of you probably understand what I mean by that. Not people like me hustling for our humanity to be recognized. I mean, people supported to see their blind spots, right? The things they haven't been willing to see in themselves before or couldn't. And then we think about organizational culture change. And absolutely, at an organizational level, we need to have structural changes like those policy changes that I've mentioned. And I've thought so much about accountability. And no accountability and selective accountability undermine all the progress that we can make here. All right. So then I was thinking about, well, where does accountability actually happen in an organization? And I'm not talking about the quantitative metrics here, although those are important, but I'm talking about when someone makes an assumption that one of my relatives is using alcohol and that's their cause of their emergency room presentation, who intervenes in that, right? Accountability for that. And mostly that happens at a team level, at a more micro level. Who is willing to speak up there? And not only who is willing to speak up, but who is actually mandated and has the authority to hold people accountable, right? To make those shared assumptions and biases that harm people visible, and then to challenge them. And so a couple notes on environment and accountability. This is one of my new favorite quotes from Brenda Harrington, who is a Black leadership coach from the United States. And I was listening to a podcast. If you follow my Leadership Lodge account, you probably saw this earlier this week. It says, what makes the difference is being willing to hold people accountable. She was talking about adaptive leadership and equity and inclusion-based work, right? But what makes the biggest difference is being willing to hold people accountable. So sometimes what gets in our way is that we are afraid to use punitive accountability mechanisms, or we realize they're sometimes counterproductive because they shut people down. When people get too defensive, they might even leverage other mechanisms in their own defense that becomes a block to any possible humility or learning. Okay. And then I saw this model, the one that you see on the left there, around supportive accountability. And when I was looking at this 2x2 table of, you know, low accountability to high accountability, that's going horizontally, low support to high support, and reflecting on, like, when I think about lack of cultural safety or anti-Indigenous racism, what quadrant are we most likely to be in? Like, most of the time, it's actually total avoidance, right? Sometimes it's even supportive accountability. That sounds like, oh no, that person went up north for years, or they couldn't possibly be racist, or that person is such a committed educator, we've never heard this kind of feedback before, right? It doesn't mean that feedback wasn't deserved. It meant maybe nobody was willing to give the feedback previously because it wasn't safe enough. And so we have to think about, how can we move to more supportive accountability models? And then the bottom there is around psychological safety. Again, psychological safety, a feature that's held in teams. Amy Edmondson defines it as the belief that one will not be punished or humiliated for speaking up with ideas, questions, concerns, or mistakes. And she has done studies that clearly show that more psychologically safe healthcare teams report more mistakes, but have better patient safety outcomes, right? That's actually what we want to see happen. We want to surface more so they can be intervened in to improve outcomes, right? And when it comes to making the kind of adaptive changes in anti-racism and cultural safety that we want to make, we want to have people in the learning zone. Very often we have people in the apathy or anxiety zone, right? Low psychological safety states when we think about medical education or the state of the healthcare system. Going to be really hard to make these changes and have that accountability if we can't support teams to be in the learning zone. So with all of these factors in mind, and before I tell you some of the strategies we're implementing, I'd like to ask you, what kind of strategies would you prioritize? Maybe I'll get some new ideas here too, or some affirmation for the ones I'll mention briefly. We'll just give it another couple minutes here. Oh, and I should have been more specific. Early education, absolutely important. I kind of meant leadership strategies or culture change strategies in medical schools or academic spaces. Okay. So we can see the kind of ideas that are coming in here. Group training, role playing, looking at decision-making processes, trying to increase psychological safety, run a humility culture, radical candor, interesting. Maybe someone can cover that topic next. There's an interesting podcast about radical candor and psychological safety. If you haven't heard that one, you might be interested. Mentors sharing own learning and mistakes. Yeah, normalizing that. Integrate education throughout training, so continuous. Yes, excellent. Different criteria for recruiting, assessing. What you permit, you promote. Yeah. And vice versa, what you promote, you permit. Algorithms, accountability for leaders too. Great answers. So as those continue to come in, I'm just going to talk a little bit about some of the strategies that we're doing, and then we'll have at least 10 minutes left for some questions and answers as well. So you can be getting ready for those if you haven't already. So one thing that I've implemented this past year is actually a group leadership coaching program here in Rady. For leaders to improve their confidence, skills, plans around anti-racism and social justice. And part of the reason I used a group leadership coaching program, in part, like it kind of allows more people to be involved than my time would otherwise allow. But in the group, we can build these coalitions so people don't feel isolated, like, oh, I'm the only leader trying to do this. People can access shared wisdom in the group. We get to do some practice coaching and some coaching demonstrations. So with that applied learning, and then when people do their own individual action planning, they're more likely to be to implement it. In our social justice and anti-racism toolkit, we drafted anti-racism and cultural safety competencies that can be used in hiring processes for leaders in the faculty. We've included some anti-racism and inclusion competencies on the performance review so that when the dean is having annual performance review conversations, he's specifically talking about this with individuals. We also developed a 2-page guide on how to use them, so what to be looking for. Last year, we had a series on learning about restorative leadership, as well as training facilitators in restorative justice processes. Now, this year, we are trying to embed access to restorative processes and further the learning around restorative processes as a form of deep accountability grounded in Indigenous ways of knowing and being and teaching. And then also last year, I did my certification in fearless organization scanning, have worked with one team on campus already around doing the scan and supporting their action planning to increase the psychological safety in the environment. And that was all just to set the stage and to continue to set the stage for the education intervention. In the education intervention, instead of like a straight expert educator learner model, we're actually implementing a coach facilitator model. So when people are going through these online asynchronous modules, they'll have the option to connect with a coach for a 15 to 20 minute conversation. So if they're feeling some discomfort, but they really want to lean into it and develop a plan to move through and integrate the learning, they're really excited about something and they want to accelerate their action planning. If they're having a related scenario at work and similarly, they want some support in developing an approach for that, they could talk with a coach, and that's meant to allow that kind of almost real-time support to translate the education into different action. We're also going to encourage teams to take the training across roughly the same point in time. We think that's going to help kind of lower the water level and surface some of those below the surface things that might otherwise be unsaid by creating safe field and actually permission and expectation that we're having conversations about what we're learning and how it applies, you know, in the classes that we're teaching or the care that we're providing. And then lastly, we'll be doing these in-person consolidation workshops. So if teams take the course over the same period of time, we'll be able to do a workshop just for that team that would combine some individual action planning with some team-based action planning. And then we'll have kind of more general workshops for people who aren't part of a team taking it as well. And so someone had written multi-pronged approaches in there, supporting humility, self-compassion, but really trying to do that experimentation of this is what I've learned, now I'm going to try this differently. Don't know if it'll work or not, but I'm going to try it. If it doesn't work, I'll try something else again. That is really what we are aiming for here. And again, with our team having that humility, knowing we might need to change course as well. But what we've done before hasn't had the impacts that we wanted. So these are the types of things that we are trying now. So I hope that is helpful for you and gives you some ideas. I have shared my Leaders Lodge Instagram here. That's my leadership and executive coaching account. If you're interested, scan it there, follow.
Amazing. Thank you again so much, Marsha, for taking the time to do this and for getting us to think around this concept of culture change and our role in moving us forward just that little bit differently. And hope we've all taken things away in our work, wherever our field is and however we want to make impact. So really appreciate everyone's taking the time to join us. Look for future Wellbeing Matters webinar series sessions and find out about College of Academic Medicine Initiative work through our website and you're kind of local leader in your faculty. So thanks again, everyone, for joining us. And I'm sure we'll see you again in future sessions. And Marsha, we'll look to hope and collaborate with you in the future.